One of our speakers is already on stage. Welcome, Cody. Yeah, you can drink. You can drink.
Hey, Matt. Glad to be here.
Yeah, glad to have you here. Cody and I have had this problem. I'll call it a problem. I moved to Colorado Springs in April, and we've yet to still meet up, and we're like 10 minutes from each other. So, but we're virtual, so yeah.
We'll meet up once this weather clears out, Matt.
Hey, this weather's a great reason to meet up. Just be stuck inside or somewhere hanging out drinking warm drinks. Yeah, welcome everyone that's joining. Welcome, welcome. We're just getting started here in a minute. We got an agile contracting conversation up. I see that Victoria's waiting as long as possible to be on screen. There she is. Look at that.
I was going to make you sweat it out a little bit. I thought about waiting until right at 2 o'clock to jump in.
Well, luckily, I already knew you were backstage. Somebody earlier, one of our speakers, I was calling them like 2 minutes before I started, like, hey, let's go. So, yeah, but it's all good. I can't sweat. The window's open because it's hot in here. And it's 12 degrees outside. But that's what I get for dancing. So, yeah, welcome everybody that's joining. Hey, Gerald, welcome back. We'll get started here in a minute. As you know how these sessions have gone. On stage, we got Cody Paul and Victoria Weiler. Two people they got, we'll use the word, I'm not actually going to tease it. They're going to surprise you how they got into this world and how they got connected to all this fun stuff. Rocker, your Space Camp sweater today. Gerald, that's awesome. Loving it. You'll have to wear it tomorrow during the industry day so people can see it on video. Looking forward to this for 2 days. Douglas has been waiting. See, Victoria, I told you. People want this conversation.
I know. What worries me is there's so much to talk about when it comes to acquisitions. I could take the rest of the webinar. I won't. Don't sign me up for that. But, there's just so much to talk about.
I was going to say, I chimed in earlier on a conversation with Anisa's panel. I was just told her acquisitions is pretty easy, actually. So, we don't have much to talk about.
Yeah, if it were up to Cody, we'd be done in like 2 minutes. So lucky you have Patty Cathy here.
Well, Cody can be done because Rob's already here watching. You just committed to doing more panels when you said, I'll do all of them. That's what I just heard. So that's on video, recorded. Yep, video proof. So, all right, well, we're going to get started. So welcome, everyone. Top of the hour, 12 o'clock Mountain Time, whatever time it is, wherever you are, because we have people all over the world for this session, which is fantastic. And our Netherlands person's here, so exciting. They are going to talk about agile contracting. Yeah, there's an oxymoron, we'll see. They've got a lot of good stuff. They're gonna drop some knowledge, tell you their journey, their story, how they became part of this world. And so without further ado, I will do what I do, disappear. And leave the stage over to Victoria Weiler coming to us from the Air Force right now, and Cody Paul coming from the Space Force, aka Space Camp. So, Victoria, Cody, over to you.
Awesome. Thanks, Matt. Appreciate everything. So, I think I'm going to go ahead and share my screen here. Let's see if we can figure this out. Awesome. All right. So, before I begin today, I have to put out a disclaimer. The thoughts and opinions discussed here today are my own and do not reflect those of the Department of the Air Force or the United States Space Force. I say that because I have been called out in the past, and I just want you to know that everything that we talk about here today is truly coming from my personal perspective and Victoria's personal perspective. So if you have issues with it or you want to talk about, please feel free to hit me up. I'm sure someone can drop my email in the chat. That being said, I am Cody Paul. I'm an active duty Space Force officer working in acquisitions. I have been in the military now for 18 and a half years, started my career in logistics, did that for about 5 years at Travis Air Force Base, and then moved over to contracting where I was stationed at Luke Air Force Base and helped with the bed down of the initial F-35 capabilities out there, did some deployments with the Defense Contract Management Agency to the Middle East. And then I moved over to be an instructor at the United States Air Force Expeditionary Center, where I taught contingency contracting, as well as contingency response mission planning. From there, I transitioned to become a acquisition program manager, where I started at the Unified Platform Program Office down in San Antonio, Texas, where I led the source selection of the system coordinator that we had, followed by the software environment services, the off-base facility that we had, our off-base location we had for the program office. And then I got recruited to come over and help stand up DoD Platform One with a couple of folks that, you know, you probably are aware of. And so did that for almost 3 years, helped out with the acquisitions and contracting. And then finally, I decided to join the Space Force because why not pivot at, you know, 16 years into your career and try something new. So I've been with the Space Force now for almost 2.5 years, really enjoying my time as the acquisition and strategy lead for the Air Force Research Lab, Space Vehicles Directorate, Agile Space Operations Branch here in Colorado Springs, working at Catalyst Campus at a location formerly known as Space Camp. And so that's me in a nutshell. I like long walks on the beach. I like the outdoors, going hiking. I have a family. As you can see, my girls are in that picture right there. I also have two boys who are heavily invested in sports. So the majority of my time is spent, you know, going back and forth to practices and other things. So that's me in a nutshell. Before I pass it over to Victoria, I just have to also mention one thing. When we were initially asked to do this, I said there's no way I'm doing it without Victoria. And I think she pretty much said the same thing. I think that was her only exception that I had to be here. So Victoria, I really appreciate it. We've worked together for a long time now, and whenever we were working together at Platform One, I truly enjoyed my time. And I think that we moved some mountains while we were there. So with that, I'll pass it over to you.
Your intro is significantly better than mine. So thank you for the kind words. As Cody mentioned, my name is Victoria. I see some comments about my dog. His name is Hagrid. He's actually right here by my feet. It's fantastic. He's the best dog there is. But I'm currently active duty Air Force. I've been in for about 9.5 years. So I have half as much experience as Cody here. I've done various roles in contracting, you know, operational and systems, and then a little bit of time in program management, but acquisitions is literally all I've done in the Air Force. And you can ask Cody, it's probably the one thing I talk about most besides, you know, dogs and baby stuff. So very excited to be here with Cody, because as he said, you kind of picked this up within the briefing. It is really people personality driven. And between the two personalities and working with him, we were able to accomplish a lot. We're very excited to share that with you today and talk about agile acquisitions. Before we actually dive into the slides though, I want to caveat with the fact that there are so many briefings out there that discuss agile acquisitions or how to be innovative in contracting. That information is out there. We hope to be slightly different today and take the approach of, you know, what is it actually like to try to implement some of these concepts? They sound great on our PowerPoint. They sound super easy and straightforward when you just, you know, have someone present it to you, but what is the reality of trying to do it? A lot of the first-hand experience that Cody and I have really comes from not only working with like our internal, very traditional team, but I would say what, like 15 other organizations throughout the DoD, Cody, that we worked with, that we worked with all of these acquisition teams. And what you quickly find out is that most all of them have very, very minimal of any experience in DevSecOps. So through not only helping ourselves, but helping other organizations, we truly learn like what works well, right? Obviously all the room for improvement and what we can be doing. I think we could have a whole briefing on just things that we need to fix. And then obviously based on what we learn, the different ideas and concepts we really wanted to pursue to kind of bring the entire acquisition community forward to meet the pace of DevSecOps. So we have a lot to cover today. Very excited to be here and obviously cannot wait to redirect all of your questions to Cody. It's what we agreed upon before briefing. I said, I'll do this if you answer all the questions. So now that it's said and it's going to be on YouTube, we're good to go.
Okay, so I just have to say, whenever Victoria and I worked together, she was the person, the creative mind with all of the great ideas and wanted to go conquer the world. And I was, if you, you know, from a technology perspective, if we could use an analogy, she was the front end, right? And I was the back end, the hamster wheel, making stuff happen and trying to level set and manage expectations to where we could try to conquer the world, but piece by piece, not taking it all over at a time. So.
Sure. Well, we can dive into the slides. We can actually start with how everything got started. So it actually goes back 2019. I had just PCS'd to the DC area, and some random guy named Rob Slaughter had given my name to another guy named Nick Shalon. And on this email, it was Cody and me, and it said that, you know, they were going to pursue, some very random dude. We're going to create the acquisition strategy to scale DevSecOps across the DoD. And so Cody and I are looking at that, like, sounds great, sounds really cool, sounds like a great challenge. But then, you know, you scroll down this email and it says, all right, we're going to do this. We're going to create an enterprise initiative. You have 45 days to do it. Okay, 45 days, cool. And then you follow it up with, you know, we're not really sure what the requirement is going to be because, you know, we don't know what all of our DoD customers are going to need. So we don't have a firm requirement. All right. And then the last part was, by the way, you have no money. So if you can imagine taking those three things to any acquisition team throughout the DoD, probably wouldn't have been met very well. But that is what we had at hand, right? This is our challenge. We had 45 days to do it. And we're actually really excited. Not everyone else was, but we were really excited to get started. And obviously that was the genesis of the acquisition strategy for Platform One. So Cody, did I miss anything that you want to add to our beginning?
No, yeah. One of the things I want to point out is, you know, we get some random email as a lieutenant. I get an email from an SES at the Pentagon telling me that we have to develop an acquisition and contracting strategy that can be executed in 45 days. And oh, by the way, it has to be at scale for the DoD. So that was definitely a daunting task that, you know, I had pondered on for a while before Victoria came on board. And then finally, when Victoria came on board, like I said, you know, I think our personalities mesh very well together, and she was the bright idea person, and we were able to pull it off, really. So as you can see from the slide, there are a couple of the OGs from Platform One. Obviously, you know, Austin Bryan, Jeff McCoy, Rob Slaughter, Matt Houston, Patrick Lorigan, Nick Shalon, Dr. Roper, Ms. Knossenberger. Really, this is the genesis of how all this started. We literally sat in a room at the Pentagon. And it was crazy because, you know, I'd been in for 16 years and I'd never visited the Pentagon, but within a span of like 4 months, I was there like a handful of times. But we sat in a room at the Pentagon and we really slapped the table on what we're going to do moving out and moving forward. And we were going to push boundaries. We were going to break down barriers. And, you know, we were given the marching orders of like, hey, if problems arise, like, come direct to the senior leadership and they have our backs and we can move out and move forward this. So we were able, like I said, to do some pretty phenomenal things and move the needle when it came to agile acquisitions within DevSecOps for the DoD.
So with that, we're really going to emphasize like what worked well for us, obviously what we need to fix in the future. But sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
No, you're good. But yeah, as Victoria was mentioning, you know, whenever we started this activity and really standing up a program, we didn't have any special authorities. There was literally nothing. We didn't get anything waivered. We were able to do things within the constraints of the federal acquisition regulation just by coming up with ideas. You know, we use things like modular contracting that we're going to talk about here in a little bit, incentivizing our vendor pool, really open communication with industry as well as our customers. And so, you know, we just want to point out that there was no like secret wand that was waved and said, you can go and do these things. We literally had to figure it out on our own. And I think, you know, with our combined experiences, the reason that we were able to execute and move forward so well is because we had that internal knowledge of understanding what needed to happen in order for it to move forward. Another thing that I want to talk about is, you know, a lot of times in acquisitions, we work in silos, and we didn't do that. We literally had the team working together hand in hand on a daily basis. At our standups, we had the users there. We had, you know, Austin at the time really giving us direction and prioritizing the things that we needed to be focused on and executing. And oh, by the way, as Victoria mentioned, we did this with zero budget, which is pretty phenomenal. We started the first year we were there and we were able to gain $80 million in user funds and then establish vehicles for, you know, up to $180 million worth of ceiling. So like I said, we did all of that within the constraints of the federal acquisition regulation. There was no secret sauce. It was literally putting our heads down to the grind and making it happen. And oh, by the way, our team was literally, you can count them on two hands. So we didn't have a large, robust pool of folks who were helping us. It was literally us day to day moving out and making it happen.
And I just want to add, like, having special authorities outside of the FART is fantastic, but it does not mean that you will move fast, right? It is the methodology of how you take what resources you have and how you apply it to achieve something. So we just really wanted to iterate that. Everything that we did was truly within the FART. So you want to go next slide? So to start off, you know, what worked really well for us when we were pursuing the acquisition strategy for Platform One, the first thing that we really had to look at was this 45-day timeline constraint. Right. So if you actually go to the next slide, Cody. When we talk acquisition timeline, we're not just referencing like what you know, just contract award. There are many, many processes prior to contract award that are required to even get there. And so when we're looking at 45 days, we had to cram all of these phases into that and do them right and do them well. And so I know when we're doing our market research, we were looking for different enterprise solutions that currently existed or new ones or people that could help us execute new ones. And I remember we were getting quotes of, you know, 12 to 18 months to get something on contract. And I was like, you know, just like us going to an acquisition team saying, we don't have a firm requirement. We need something done in 45 days and you have no money. I could only imagine going back to, you know, the Pentagon and being like, oh yeah, you want us to support this DoD DevSecOps initiative? We can do it for you in 18 months. So we knew that wasn't gonna go over well. We knew we really needed to evaluate how we were doing something. So if you go back to the previous slide, Cody, what we decided.
Yeah, real quick, Victoria, I just want to point out that meme, that was not Rob Slaughter. I'm pretty sure that guy has a PhD too, but that was not that Rob Slaughter. Yeah.
He's easily confused, we understand, right? No, so going back, what we had to do is we actually changed our methodology. So rather than spending months and months and months creating a perfect contract strategy, we took the approach of we're gonna do the minimum viable product of contract strategies. We know it's not gonna be perfect, and that is actually our intent. We wanna put something out there that is flexible, that allows us to iterate based on what we learn. So that was our original goal. It worked really well for us having that mindset and kind of sharing that mindset with not only industry, but also our leadership, saying we're asking for approval for something that we know is not perfect, right? That is part of our strategy. And we also leveraged a lot of principles from other entities that were trying to do innovative things as well. I know when, after I got that email, the first thing we did was we called some of our closest coworkers from other innovative organizations that were doing similar problems at a smaller scale. And we said, come help us, right? We pulled them in downtown San Antonio. We locked everyone in a room and we stole the concept of a contracting sprint. We just said, hey, we're gonna do a contracting sprint. We're gonna give ourselves 4 days. And so within those 4 days, we're going to come up with a strategy. We're going to have all the documentation for that strategy, and we're going to end the sprint with the actual approval for that strategy. And believe it or not, we were actually able to do it by having all the key people that needed to be decision makers in that room. We didn't do any like review before the review. Everyone was there, everyone contributed. And then once we were done, we were done. So we took that mindset with the contracting sprint to get that strategy in place. And then obviously, you know, start getting offers in place. We said, we're gonna take that same concept and apply it to our technical evaluations. What was really cool about this technical evaluation sprint that we did is we actually pulled in really great engineers from lots of different organizations. Not only did that help us with our resource constraints, right? We only have so many engineers on our team. It also helped with that buy-in, right? If we involve people from other organizations to help develop something that is for the enterprise, that is for the ecosystem, they're more willing to be bought in and more willing to use it and support it and advocate for it. So our theory was if we get people involved to help us with these evaluations, you know, they'll go back and say, hey, I'm interested in what they're doing. I want to see how we can help. And then obviously we extended the concept of pitch days, which are just oral presentations. And we applied that to what we were doing. We brought industry in, we did oral presentations, we made decisions on the spot. All of these things were fantastic and it allowed us to really move quickly without a budget within that 45-day timeframe, but it would not have been possible had we not collaborated with the folks that were already existing in the ecosystem, right? What we didn't want to do was have one small acquisition team just managing everything for the entire, you know, DevSecOps initiative. We wanted it to come together as a community to really build something that was great. So that was our initial intent, our initial mindset. It worked really, really well for us. And it allowed us to actually, you know, build something quickly. So Cody, do you want to go over modular contracting?
Yeah, absolutely. So when it comes to modular contracting, one of the concepts that we wanted to test out was modular contracting. In my personal experience over the years, what we found was industry would love to bid on a proposal or solicitation and say, hey, I'm going to bid on this for 5 years. And it gets awarded. And guess what? The performance isn't up to par with what we're looking for in the government. They're not moving at the speed we need them to. They're not providing the talent that we need them to. And they understand that they have a contract vehicle for 5 total years. And so what we wanted to do is we wanted to have the ability and the flexibility to onboard vendors with shorter periods of performance. That way, you know, if their performance wasn't up to stuff, we had the ability to offboard them, right? We didn't have to exercise their option. So we'd create a base period of like 3 to 6 months, and we test them out, right? And if they weren't a good fit for the culture, or they weren't a good fit performance or schedule or cost-wise, we had the ability and the flexibility to offboard them. And then, you know, we also did things like streamlining processes to where, you know, we said in our solicitations that we have the ability to make multiple awards on a solicitation, right? So, you know, we had industry leave their proposals open for a set amount of time. That way, if vendor A came in and they weren't performing well within those 3 months that we talked about, we had the ability to make another award on top of that to vendor B, who was in the pool because their proposal was still valid. And that flexibility really helped us out. And it kind of drove internal competition as well from our industry base, because they understood that, like, hey, if we're not performing, guess what? They're going to offboard us. Another thing is, you know, we were as transparent as possible as what we could be with industry. We initiated AMAs, Ask Me Anything, after we released our initial solicitation. So we had multiple AMAs to go over, you know, thoughts and concerns from industry. We addressed their questions. As I mentioned, you know, we wanted to be as transparent as possible because we understood that, you know, none of this happens without the defense industrial base. There's no way that we could do this internally with just government blue suitors. So we relied heavily on them. And I think what that did is it improved their relationship, right? Because we were constantly asking for feedback from them. We were asking for feedback internally. We were collaborating, as Victoria mentioned, with other ecosystems to see how they were doing it. And then finally, you know, we talk about portfolio diversification. We didn't want to rely on a sole vendor to say that they own the entire baseline, right? So it wasn't like a traditional system integrator or coordinator who came in and literally just built this thing for the government. Our philosophy was that we were going to own the tech baseline, and then we were going to have industry partner and work together to collaborate in order to solve the hard problems that, you know, our engineering teams had. And so, you know, managing and juggling that portfolio is pretty burdensome from an administration side, and we'll talk about that here in a little bit. But what it did is kind of drove this ecosystem of culture of like, hey, everything is performance based. If you're not, you know, up to snuff on what we're trying to accomplish here, like, we have the ability and the flexibility to offboard you and go to another one who's hungry, who wants this, who wants to be involved with something new for the Department of Defense, and really drive this forward. So Victoria, did you want to hit on this anymore? I know you talked about it a little bit, but with, you know, HALT, procurement acquisition lead time, as Victoria said, we had the huge demise of going from traditional 6 month contract awards down to 30 to 45 days. And so the team of acquisition professionals that we had were able to consistently get to an average of 30 to 45 days to put folks on contract, which was kind of unheard of.
And a lot of what we did to achieve that goal, we did a lot of things up front. So we looked at what can we do at kind of like the enterprise level that provides that blank approval to allow us just to execute, right? So we did a lot of work up front, and we put a lot of things into our ordering guide to let industry know how things were gonna work, right? That we were gonna move quickly. And back to that transparency concept, we were very transparent with what we wanted to do and what we intended to do. And that essentially held us accountable as well. I remember there's one day where we We had told industry we were going to solicit or release a solicitation by the end of the week, and it was Valentine's Day. And we're sitting there on a Friday night on Valentine's Day talking to legal to make sure that we get the solicitation out on time, like we told industry, because we wanted to build that working relationship with not only our government partners, but with the DIB as well.
Yeah, my wife still doesn't let me live that one down. So,
so a lot of what we did that worked really well, worked well initially, right? So everything we did, we would award a contract, and then we would go back and we would talk to every single vendor and ask for feedback. We would say, what did you like? What didn't you like? What could we do better? And we gained all of this feedback, right? It was very, very eye-opening. But what we quickly find out, and this is where we needed to figure out how to fix this in the future, is our ability to iterate on that feedback was very difficult. You look at like software, you can change software code within seconds or minutes. For a contract to be modified, you're talking about weeks or if not months. So to have that iterative continuous update on a contract is not necessarily as feasible as we wanted it to be. So we had all this feedback, but like, what is the point if we're not doing something with it, right? And that extends to the feedback that we provided to industry as well. You know, whether it was just a debrief or like a selection notice, when we are talking with industry, are we giving them information that they actually care about that is actually gonna help them improve in the future? I can't tell you how many times we look at debriefing slides and we're like, what, how is that gonna help anyone, right? But on that same token, are we giving feedback for actual future opportunities that exist? Cody mentioned the whole modular contracting concept. You know, if we're getting locked into one vendor for the next 5 years, I would be upset as industry as well. Like, let's give feedback for future opportunities that are right around the corner. So that was our intent, right? We're going to say it's a no now, but if you work on these things, it's a future yes, right? Or a potential yes. We wanted to make sure we were providing that meaningful feedback, that transparency. And that also extends to our government partners, right? I can't tell you how often, you know, acquisitions is very hesitant to share documents that they have internally, right? For fear of recrimination. There's a significant recrimination culture that still exists. It's gotten better, but it still exists, where people are afraid to share what they're doing and how they're doing it for fear of someone saying, hey, you can't do that, or I don't think you should be doing that. We have to break that down with not only industry, but also government. We live in this world where we're so terrified that we're going to get protested, that we're not transparent. And so rather than looking at what information we can share that's meaningful and will actually help, we'd rather just keep everything to ourselves so we don't get protested, because a protest will completely derail the timeline. So if we can kind of work on that relationship, right, that transparency, that's how you build that working relationship with industry. So that's something that we realized even we needed to improve on, right? We're giving this information out, but is it useful? And then obviously we mentioned and we hit on collaboration a lot, right? We did a lot initially with other folks in the ecosystem. Was it continuous? Not as much as it should have been. And what I mean by this is, you know, acquisition is resource constrained. We mentioned how we leverage other people to help get ideas and strategies in the beginning. We needed to continue doing that in the long term. Same applies to opportunities and requirements. We're all trying to do the same thing. There were so many opportunities where we could go in on a solicitation together to, you know, get requirements together. And I want to reference back that, you know, that one bullet that Cody mentioned where we had three solicitations with the potential for 19 contract awards. Well, the intent and how it worked out was we ended up making those multiple awards internal to Platform One. The hope was we could create solicitations that everyone could benefit from, right? Where we had three solicitations, we had a rack and stack of fantastic vendors that could do these discrete services, but no one was willing to take additional contracts because they didn't own it up front. They weren't involved with building the requirement up front. So if we go back to that continuous collaboration and that initial buy-in that we had, you know, when we first started, that's what we needed to continue throughout our process. We needed to make sure that people were still bought in. So when we do something innovative and flexible, other people are able to benefit from it as well. So we had a huge opportunity. Can you imagine three solicitations all within 30, 45 days, you could have had 19 awards. But because we didn't have that continuous collaboration and buy-in, we weren't able to do as much as we wanted. This also extends to, you know, I mentioned how Cody and I have worked with a lot of acquisition teams, and I can't tell you how many times we had people come to us that said, hey, I know you have this vehicle that you built, but I want to build it myself. You're like, all right, well, you could if you really wanted to, but I don't recommend it. Why not work with us to help us build a better vehicle or to improve ours, right? So rather than recreating wheel, help us build a better wheel. I think, Cody mentioned, we work in silos all too often. And what happens is you have people doing the same thing, but no one is actually doing the same thing better, right? So how do we actually continuously improve our processes and our vehicles to make them as efficient and effective? Because honestly, you're not going to deliver capability unless you have a really, really good contract. So, and I know Cody mentioned, you know, modular contracting worked great up front, right? We had that competition. We had a lot of industry partners, but it was not sustainable. And it was not sustainable because we actually did not fix the root of the problem. We were still applying these burdensome processes on us, even though we spent time up front to try to alleviate that, right? I mentioned how we try to do justifications and approval at a higher level so we could just keep moving. What happens is you slowly revert back to your traditional ways. You don't have as much, you know, spotlight on you. You don't have as much motivation. You get new people involved. There's a new learning curve. And before you know it, you're like, I'm back to the most traditional program office that I've ever been in. So are those processes sustainable? That's what we really face. But do you want to add on to that or no?
Yeah, absolutely. And so when we talk about modular contracting as well, one of the things, you know, that I mentioned was portfolio diversification. Whenever we set up the acquisition strategy for Platform One, we always were interested and invested in the Small Business Innovation Research program through AFWERCS that the Air Force was doing at the time. And so that continuous collaboration allowed us to do things like host one of their contracting sprints to get to better know them, to understand their processes, to help them out where we could, and they would help us out in return. And then, you know, we also leveraged other vehicles as well. So we had GSA, we had the basic ordering agreements, we had IDIQs that were available to us. So there were a ton of vehicles that we could use out there. The issue that we always ran into was really the demand from our dev teams and understanding that, you know, software doesn't even happen overnight. It happens literally in minutes or seconds, right? So if you need to update or you need a license or you need whatever, it has to be available at the speed of relevance. And so that was kind of our philosophy moving into it, was we need to be able to acquire and get things on contract as soon as possible. And so that was always our mantra of moving fast. But as, you know, Victoria mentioned, for sustainable processes, you know, we absolutely leverage modular contracting, but there's a huge administrative burden that goes along with that. So executing those options, if you have a 3-month option or a 6-month option, keeping track of your costs, your schedule, your performance, that's a huge burden on a team of, you know, a handful of folks. And also there's other things like, you know, contracting officer representative core duties that had to take place, and make sure that the proper surveillances were going on, making sure that invoices were paid, making sure that timelines were met. All of those things create a huge burden. And for a small acquisition team, there definitely wasn't a hurting for work, I could tell you that.
We talk about that burden. We wanted to pursue modular contracting for various reasons. We also wanted to continue doing contracting over and over and over again with the hopes that you do it so often that you get really good at it and then you have natural efficiencies. The issue with that, like, it sounds great. Cody mentioned the administrative burden, but it's also hard to just keep afloat with those contracts while also iterating and improving them. So it was very hard to balance, like, do we just continue with modular contracting or do we pause, reevaluate, see what we need to do better? It's very taxing on a small team to kind of take all of this on at once. Plus the government turnover. Can't tell you how many times you got a new person and you're spinning them back up and you're like, what is DevSecOps? Let's start from day one, you know?
Yeah, another frustrating piece of that is, you know, we held interviews for folks who wanted to join the team, either from a civilian perspective or even a military perspective. And, you know, the processes that we have in place for hiring, they were just, you know, handcuffing us. We would interview folks in January and say, these are amazing individuals who definitely need to be on our team. And then 6 months later, they'd finally get an offer. Well, you can't, you know, hold it against them that they went and they're out there with industry who's, you know, can hire them in weeks, where we had to wait months. Another thing was, you know, Victoria mentioned earlier about having the right folks to execute on a day-to-day basis. The right mentality, the right fit for the culture is important. You know, we tried to be as selective as possible in recruiting and retaining folks. But like I said, you know, the systems just aren't in place to date to where I can snap my fingers and have someone who I think will be an amazing acquirer on my team. So incentivizing and retaining talent was definitely something that we harped on. We always were beating our battle drum that we needed more resources, whether that be an actual budget, or, you know, individuals who could help us out, when it came to executing all of this administrative burden that we had.
Well, and to add to that, this concept, while also it applies to government, right? How do we keep really good people that want to do this type of stuff, right? Where the nature of our environment is we move people so often, right? But there's a lot of people that are interested in this, that want to do this, that want to be in positions that they have authority and the ability to make change. We don't necessarily, you know, support that. This also applies to industry, right? So all of the contract efforts that we were going after, we were trying to get top tier talent. We quickly realized that we need better ways to incentivize industry to give us their talent. We learned that a lot of companies have great people, but they can't hold on to those people for months on end, right? So if we take very long to, you know, make a contract award, oftentimes the key personnel that we'd make an award on was already moved to another project. So we quickly learned if we can tell industry no or yes as soon as possible, that is ideal, right? Either let the person move on, or give them an opportunity to actually work with us. Because just like Cody said with the hiring process, we wait 6 months to get someone an offer, they're already on another team. Same thing applies to industry. We wait months and months to get a contract award. By the time the contract's awarded, that industry key personnel is already onto bigger and better things. This also applies to what type of models we can look at that, you know, incentivizes industry to give us their top tier talent. Is there a model that allows them to do dual use, not just government purpose, but also commercial? We wanted that feedback on what we could do better to ensure we are getting the best people on our problem sets. So what else did we learn? This is probably my absolute favorite topic. I could talk about this concept for forever. It's what I'm most passionate about. It's honestly education enablement. We can talk about all the concerns and issues within the acquisition community, but it all comes from the lack of education and enablement. And what I mean by this, and you can actually go back to Platform One and how Platform One acquisition team started, was we were actually enabled by other members within the community. So we had other folks come sit down with us, help us strategize, give us ideas, you know, really talk through things, and, you know, honestly sometimes tell us, no, you can do it. You don't have to ask for permission. You have this within your authority. Have those conversations with us. That is key to scaling this beyond one or two teams. There are a lot of PowerPoints, right? On, like I mentioned, on agile acquisitions, on how to do this types of transformation, but it goes beyond that PowerPoint. It goes, you know, sitting with an individual and really working with them. This is what Cody and I tried to do in our spare time, was work with those other organizations and really work through their problems, brainstorm with them, identify what issues they were having and how we could help address those issues. That was key. And I also want to emphasize that, you know, while that enablement key is part or important, you have that education aspect that also goes hand in hand. I mentioned I didn't have any technical background at all when I started. And that is probably the majority of the acquisition community. They don't have a technical background. So we found that breaking down what is DevSecOps? So what does it mean? Why should you care? And why do you need to actually change how you acquire to support? That was key to all of this, really explaining that. But it also goes the reverse, right? Getting our engineers to the table as well, so they can understand why your acquisition or your contracting officer is asking a million questions, why they keep turning back documents because they need more information, kind of bridging that gap between the two parties of the team to understand, like, as a team, it's a whole movement, right? It's not just acquisitions and engineering. So we were really starting to do this before COVID hit. We were actually doing a lot of the stuff in person. And as a result, it actually generated some really great training out there that exists to date. But the issue is, how do you scale it? So while it exists, how do you scale it? And how do you make it the very, very beginning of anyone's digital transformation, right? Someone wants to figure out how to acquire software. They go and learn about it first, and then they work with a team to help them strategize and come up with an idea. I'm also very passionate about this because my biggest fear is if you have one or two people on a team that are the only ones thinking of things to do, you have one school of thought. And that's awful. You're never going to get better if you're the only one thinking about things. So we made a concerted effort to really go throughout the community, find out what other organizations were doing, steal their good ideas, and see how that applied to us. So we got a lot of great ideas that we wanted to kind of incorporate into our model. But going back to iterating on feedback, the acquisition community is not very flexible to iterate, as we found out. So with that, I'll hand it over to you, Cody.
Yeah, so I know we talked a lot about the burden of acquisitions, but you know, in the tech world, there's this thing called technical debt. Well, in the acquisitions world, we also have acquisition debt. You know, it doesn't end after contract award on the government side. Just because you let a contract doesn't mean that everything stops and you're good and you have the contractor indefinitely. There are things that you have to do. Like in the chat, I see the common access cards. CACs are a huge blocker to anything. So we would have folks who we awarded a contract to, and they would be in the penalty box waiting on their CAC. And it was like, this is ridiculous. Fortunately enough, you know, our engineers came up with a way where they could start doing work outside of the government network. But it was a huge burden. It was something that we tried to tackle, and we tried to onboard folks as fast as possible to get them to where they needed to be. DD-254s, security clearances, all of those things come into play as well. So if we're doing development on the high side, working through the wickets of making sure that our security office has the proper documentation, and then the folks are actually cleared to do those duties in those environments, was also a huge burden. I mentioned core duties. I'll be the first to say that I was the only core while I was there, my time at Platform One, and it was frustrating. As I'll get out, there was a ton of things to do. It was an additional duty, but it was a necessary duty. I had been a contracting officer before, so I knew kind of what I needed to do to keep my head above water. But contracting officer representatives are important. They're literally the eyes and ears of the contract. They're the ones who are ensuring that, you know, the government is getting what they pay for in a timely manner, and the performance is up to snuff. And you know, there's a ton of other things on the back end that have to take place, really, that folks just don't realize. And so, like I said, with the small team that we had, handful of folks, we were definitely busy. So if I had to change one thing about it, I would get me a team of like 100 people and then delegate everything. But obviously that wasn't where we're at. And then finally, I want to talk about billing and invoicing. So
Real quick, Cody, I just want to jump in there. When you talk about like all these things that need to happen post-contract award, capability isn't being delivered until you actually have someone in a seat doing something. And when we talked about accountability, not only in government, but on our industry side, if you're waiting months and months and months to actually get some type of product delivered or capability delivered, at that point, you're so bought in that you're just so grateful to have anyone in the seat. And we shouldn't have that mentality, right? If we can fix that back end and streamline it and get capability delivered right away, we're holding industry accountable sooner, and we can make sure that we're getting what we need. I can't tell you how many times we award a contract, 4 months later, finally someone's working. They're okay right now, what we wanted, but we don't want to walk away because we're just so grateful to have something on contract. That should not be our mentality, but we're never going to be able to change it if that back-end process isn't actually addressed. So, okay, go ahead.
Yeah, absolutely. Agree with everything you said, Victoria. And then the last thing I want to hit on is billing and invoicing. There are many ways that our industry partners are able to get paid. Whether that be through different financial systems, or if depending on the type of contract you have, if you're in an agreement or another transaction with the government, there are different systems to get paid. And so not having access to those systems, are those systems being down, or, you know, not being able to log in because my CAC pin was reset or whatever it may be can be a huge financial constraint and burden, especially on small businesses who don't have the capital to run their businesses without the money that they're intending to get from the government. So the billing and invoicing was a huge thing that we definitely dedicated a lot of time to on our part to make sure that our industry partners were getting paid and they, you know, had adequate room for runway for what they were trying to accomplish with their business.
And I think to add to this, something that really needs to be considered from the government acquisition perspective is if you're looking to work with a lot of these startups or small businesses, you need to look at models that get companies paid quickly, right? A lot of these companies don't have the bandwidth to make it, you know, 5-6 months without getting paid. So how do we structure different contracts to ensure that they're getting money as soon as possible so they can continue delivering capability? Cody has had so many companies come to him saying, yeah, you know, we've been trying to invoice, but we haven't gotten any approved for like 3 months and we only have enough money to last another week. That should never be the situation. And so it works on industry to like notify us right away. And obviously on the government side to figure out what ways can we actually restructure contracts to prevent the situation altogether.
Yes, absolutely. And I have had companies come to me and say, I haven't been paid in months. And I'm like, you're just not telling me this? Like, if I was running a business, I'd be like, no, I didn't get paid the first time, like the first month. So like, where's my money? But it's all good. We worked through it and we were able to get folks paid. So
obviously, we hit on things that worked well. We talked about, you know, all the things that we wanted to improve, things to think about. This really leads into the different ideas and concepts that we wanted to pursue. Obviously, we were resource constrained. We were assignment constrained, right? We're only on an assignment for so many years before we move on. And people constrained and buy-in, right? That was always key to have the buy-in to actually do this. I mentioned education and enablement. It was always our desire to have focused education and enablement where we had a dedicated team that was just there to help teams with DevSecOps and scaling DevSecOps across the DoD. When you have a mission, your mission will always come first. Executing the mission will be the priority. And that makes sense, right? But when you talk about scaling and making change at large for the community, you're never gonna do that if you don't focus on actually enabling and helping others. You're only gonna get this pocket of goodness, right? Where smaller groups are able to figure it out, but it'll never scale beyond that. So we wanted to make a concerted effort to actually fix that problem with the hopes that it would fix other issues in the community. We wanted to have a way where we were bringing people into our team, learning, working with us, getting their ideas, strategizing, and then transitioning them to that enablement team, where then they're then helping others, right? So you kind of learn after, you learn by doing, because I think that's key. I think a lot of the training that exists to date are people that have been out of touch with what it's really like to get some of these concepts done. So take someone that's just lived this environment, that knows what it's like to try to do this, and then put them in a position to help others because they are in the position to understand the pain points, the setbacks that they'll face. So we wanted to structure that model, that training model, to really scale beyond just our internal platform one team. We also looked at, you know, all the different processes within acquisition that we should probably be automating. We are not the fastest. I don't think anyone, well, not many people would say that acquisitions has a reputation for being fast. We don't really look at our processes and see how we can optimize them very often. So I was always jealous at all this stuff that our engineers were doing. And then I would go back to my computer with my little like Word doc and Excel spreadsheet and send emails and hope that it would send, that the file wasn't too large. So there's a lot of room for improvement with just our internal processes that if we streamline and automated, we could actually probably move a lot faster.
Yeah, absolutely. And so, you know, finally, with this build, measure, learn concept, you know, we wanted to experiment as much as possible. You know, things Victoria talked about early on, we wanted to develop a minimum viable product for acquisitions. So the contractings that we were writing, we understood that they needed to be iterated on, right? Every contract is one modification away from being perfect. And we understood that. So, you know, we would do things deliberately in our contracts and proposals to make sure that, you know, what we were trying to accomplish was hypothesized and thought out. And guess what? If it didn't work, we would iterate. We'd move on. And we'd iterate fast as well, because there are definitely some times when we failed on awarding a few contracts. We utilized test scripts for contracting. So like, hey, what is the desired outcome of what we're trying to accomplish here? And then finally, you know, we were looking for industry input and incentives, right? How do we incentivize industry to work with us? Because a lot of times, you know, I know in one of the other panels, I think it was Enrique Odie mentioned that industry isn't scared to work with the government. There's just too much red tape, and we have to lower that barrier to entry for industry to work with us. And so we do that with, you know, agile contracting vehicles. There's lab authorities out there where we can enter into things like cooperative research and development agreements. There's other transactions. Those are the things that we were trying to push the needle on when it came to that. And so with that, I think we'll stop for questions. And I don't know how much time we have, Matt, but we can definitely move into Q&A. Did we lose Matt? It's fine. I can pull up the Q&A here, Victoria, and you can answer these. Oh, here's one from Michael Pilar.
I know. What a name I missed, huh?
Yeah. First off, hey, Victoria and Cody. Secondly, the on-ramp, off-ramp process needs to be standard operating procedures for these type of acquisitions. Can you share any lessons learned about the procedures you took to determine how you could onboard or remove a new company?
Okay. So there's a lot that goes into this. Our ideal scenario was that we were going to be able to onboard and offboard. I think we wanted to start off with like once a year, but it was going to be based on performance. So that concept only works if you're providing enough opportunities for industry to actually participate and have performance on, right? What we found, one of our setbacks was that we'd have these onboarding opportunities and offboarding opportunities, but how can you offboard someone if they've never had an opportunity? So this concept would have worked great if we worked together as a community and had all of our requirements kind of funneled in one direction, because then imagine how we could actually measure performance across many, many industry partners. So that was probably the biggest lesson learned. Like, we had this great idea of how we're going to offboard, but you're limited in what you can do based on the actual number of opportunities you've given a company. Do you want to add anything, Cody?
No, yeah, I agree 100%. You know, we thought that we would have enough opportunities out there, but it just didn't pan out. And I really wish that we could go back and get a more robust, you know, pool of folks who wanted to leverage our vehicles to where we could really measure their performance and really understand, you know, like pick out who was good, who was bad. Okay, next question, Victoria. What did you do to make a...
Sorry, I know in our offboarding procedures, we also, the things that we added were like, if you don't respond to so many solicitations, then it's automatically offboarded. So we had like simple, straightforward requirements in there as well, but it was heavily determined on performance. So sorry, go ahead. Next question.
Yeah, Matt, how much time we got?
Let's go with 2 minutes.
All right, next question. I'll read it quick. What did you do to make up for the lost knowledge and speed when you offboarded a vendor at 6 months and had to bring in someone that came in cold at that 6 month point? What did you do to recover lost time and experience while also delivering at speed?
You're supposed to answer all the questions. I'm joking. So for this one, honestly, it comes down to government internal talent. If you have a really good, government talent leading your industry partners, that's where you make up for things. We needed to make a concerted effort to keep and develop our internal talent because that was key to success. If you don't have someone that knows what they're doing, how are they ever going to get someone else up to speed? So that was the continuity. That continuity is what we needed to build and develop on. So that was quick, but
okay, hopefully I think we'll do one more. And then we can stay in the room and answer offline if we need to. So per the slide, you went straight from document approval process to contract award. What was the RFP evaluation award process? Have you faced protest challenges with this approach?
I feel like I jinxed myself and I'm going to end up answering all these questions. So yes, we did the 30 days, right? We did the streamlined evaluations. We did oral presentations to kind of do that like last part of contract award all within like a week. We made that part very, very quick. We did face protests initially. We took the mentality that, hey, we originally did basic ordering agreements. They're not actual contracts. People won't protest an agreement. We were wrong. People will protest anything. And so that's where that transparency really comes into play. Like, a protest significantly derails everything. But with that transparency and saying, hey, this is the initial onboarding, you're not going to be shut out for the next 5 years. We plan on having another onboarding event. Here's the feedback on how you can be better. That is actually how we were able to quickly move past any type of protest talk, if that makes sense. So all of the document approval, contract award, we moved very, very quickly because we had that support from leadership. We had that momentum, we had that buy-in, and we had a team of people that wanted to get it done. I can't emphasize people enough. One person can completely stop the process when it comes to acquisition. So making sure you have every single personality on your team that is bought into what you're doing is key and critical if you want to move quickly.
All right, so we're going to give people, I'm going to give you guys a chance to answer a couple other of those questions because you said you got a minute. But for those I do want to respect, if you want to take a break, you can do so now before the next session. If you want to hang out with these guys for a minute while they answer a couple of these last questions, you're welcome to. Just want to respect your guys' time boxes. The next session is going to be in about 7 to 8 minutes. And it is, what's our last one? Where did we go? There it is. Service Mesh and Istio with folks from Solo and Tetra. It's going to be a great conversation. But we'll leave this room open for a few more minutes while they can answer a couple of the last questions that are in the Q&A. So thanks all. Great, great presentation overall. And yeah, so we'll leave it open. Thanks, guys.
Thanks, Matt.
Yeah, so go ahead, Cody. You can keep running down. Or maybe Victoria should read them now so that you have to answer.
Yeah, I feel like we could talk about this stuff for forever. Okay, so let's see, education. How do we tech people get access to better fundamental understanding of government acquisition process? I just want to put a plug in. The training I was referencing is called Digital DNA. It's out there. I think it's being managed at the OSD level. But Cody, go ahead. You can answer that question now.
No, yeah, I mean, absolutely. I think there's available training from DAU. As Victoria mentioned, there's Digital DNA. But really, I think on the flip side of that, as an acquisition professional, I learned the most from sitting with my users and really talking with Austin Bryan about like, hey, I don't really know what I'm buying today. Like, why is this a priority? Why is this important? Like, why do you have to have these licenses for SD elements to do scans on software? Like, you know, so really getting involved and being able to communicate closely with your acquisition team, I think you'll probably learn the best. You know, as you know, Victoria, we gave Austin a glorified warrant whenever he was done at Platform One. So, I would say, you know, definitely do the formal training, but then also the informal stuff like the day-to-day. Just getting involved and understanding like, you know, where acquisition people come from and kind of their thought process whenever they're thinking about all of the things that they have to run through, the checklist that they have to run through in order to be, you know, in compliance with federal acquisition regulations or anything else.
I also want to add, I can't tell you how many times we had engineers that came to us that wanted to be a part of this DevSecOps initiative. And they said, can you just award the contract for us? Because we don't want to deal with our own contracting officer, our own acquisition team. And 90% of the problem was just getting the contracting team to the table to explain why they needed certain things, to explain the process. There's just natural divide. And oftentimes engineers wouldn't even know who their contracting person is. It's never going to work in an agile environment if you're not actually on the same team, right?
Yeah, I would say knowing is half the battle. And we actually did award contracts in users' behalf outside organizations while we were there. Next question, is there a list somewhere of agile contracting mechanisms explained for best use? I mean, I know there's definitely reference material from DAU. You have like the contracting comb, right? But I think for best use, it really depends on the situation. Right. So, you know, every situation or every acquisition strategy or contracting strategy is going to be dependent on what exactly you're trying to do. So for us, like that's really like a requirements definition. You know, I know whenever we talk about agility, we don't really mention requirements. Really, we're just looking for the outcomes. So those outcome based, you know, requirements that we're putting on contract is something that we absolutely sat down and worked through and really tried to understand with our end users. And so from that, we would develop the strategy around it. And it's going to be different for every contracting officer, you know, and program manager. They're going to come up with, you know, I could tell you a way to do something, but they can probably tell you 10 different ways to do it. Victoria, anything to add?
So for this is this goes back to that whole like enable. I'm sorry, I don't know if you guys can hear my toddler having a meltdown in the background, so I'm trying to be quick. The whole enablement concept, what we found is contracting is comfortable with what they've done for the past, you know, 2, 5, 10 years. So when you talk about mechanisms, oftentimes it's just the contracting team or acquisition team that wanted to do with what they knew. So for best use, sometimes it's really getting someone out of their comfort shell to try something else. Oftentimes it's just saying, okay, if that's what you want to do, how can we make that even better? So it really is dependent on who you're working with in your team. And I know that's not the ideal answer, but that's what we quickly found when we were trying to help others. Next question, does Platform One leverage OTs?
Yeah, so I don't work for Platform One anymore, so I don't really want to speak for them. But I am aware that I'm pretty sure that they do have an OT within their portfolio. I don't want to talk specifics of it, but yes, they have leveraged OTs in the past. And if I'm wrong, I'm wrong. Sorry, like I said, I don't work for
but Platform when, One. When we got started, we didn't have any OT authority. So I just want to clarify, like when we first started, we didn't have that authority. But it is something that we wanted to pursue even in from the very beginning, because we wanted to have that well-rounded portfolio of, you know, the BOAs, SBIRs, OTs, GSA. We wanted to have a plethora of options, so we were never reliant on just one or someone else awarding a contract for us. Because the worst thing is when you're waiting for someone else to award your contract and you're just kept in the dark. So our theory was just have a bunch of options so we could always deliver capabilities.
All right, I think last one, this is from Misha. It says, some of the things you describe about the multiple vendors sound similar to an IDIQ contract. Why did you choose your path versus IDIQ? Victoria, you wanna take that one?
No, you go for it. I've answered that question a million times, so you can answer
it. So one of the things that we mentioned early on was we had zero budget. So we didn't have dollars for the minimum award fee for an IDIQ contract. Also with that, with an IDIQ, you know, it can still take you anywhere from 3 to 6 months to award a task order off of an IDIQ, you know, based upon your competition and how many folks you have on board. So, you know, I know there's another IDIQ out there and that was awarded around the times that we did our basic ordering agreements. And they actually came to us and said, hey, we want to award off of your basic ordering agreements because it's faster. You can get capability faster. And oh, by the way, I don't have to pay a minimum. And oh, by the way, like this 6 month process is just debilitating to everything that we're trying to accomplish with what we're doing. Also with the basic ordering agreements, that it's exactly what they are. They're agreements. So they're not necessarily binding. There's a disadvantage on the government side because we don't have that unilateral authority until an actual order is awarded. However, it provided us the most flexibility because at any given time, the government could walk away or the vendor could walk away. Victoria, anything to add?
No, we were looking for something that was very flexible, something that we knew wasn't going to be perfect. And when you start throwing around IDIQ and the term contract, that's when you open yourself up more to, okay, well, can you protest this? Agreements just seemed more flexible at the time. And obviously we had no money. And we were actually we were able to be quite creative with what we did with the agreements. Because part of everything that we did with being agile was being transparent. And we found if you do exactly what you told industry you're going to do, industry typically doesn't have a problem with that. They have a problem when you do something different from what you said you were going to do. So we are very, you know, upfront with how we're going to treat these agreements with hopes that we could be transparent and move quickly.
Great. I think it was the last question just popped up. I'll cut it off after this because I know you got things to do, Victoria, and I have a meeting to get to. But it says, is a direct to phase two D2P2 SBIR Small Business Innovation Research Award a lot of work for contracting officers? We recently lost a direct to phase two customer because their contracting officer said it would be too much work. So I will just say this. While we were at Platform One, we awarded direct to phase three contracts within a matter of 2 weeks. That was our typical average for awarding SBIR contracts because there's a lot of flexibility that SBIR gives you. It's a sole source authority. It's already been vetted. And really it's just working through awarding the contract because you can work direct with the vendor on, you know, all of your milestones or your statement of work or objectives or whatever it may be. So really for us, and I'm saying this for us, I can't speak for other contracting officers, our offices or acquisition programs, but it was relatively easy for us to develop a package for SBIR because, as I mentioned, we had that built relationship with the community at AFWERX, and we had reach back capability as well to their contracting officers and say, hey, here's my idea. Here's how I think I can accelerate this and move fast. And we had the team who could just knock out the packages and get it through review and everything that needed to happen in order for it to get awarded. Victoria, anything to add?
This just goes back to the learning curve, right? If you've never done an SBIR effort, it can be very, not confusing, but you don't understand the flexibilities that you actually have. We found that a lot with folks, whether they were trying to understand DevSecOps or to understand what SBIR was, there's always going to be a learning curve. Is it going to be too much work? It's going to be too much work if you make it too much work. The program is set up to access small businesses easily. With direct to phase twos, you probably just have to justify more so why you're going direct to them without them having a phase one. But other than that, it's you can make more work for yourself with a lot of these different efforts. So